Alright, draft physics video. Try to anyway. Just way too many things to do here. So anyway, ton of comments. Reference this, reference that. So I'll show some of that stuff, but I'll just do this contextual thing. Who's got time to do all this scrutinizing of what is claimed to be the answer? Like all the other claimed to be answers in physics, right? scratch at them a little, and they're not answers. All right, so let's understand the history of the two-slit experiment, the nail-in-the-coffin experiment. Now, in the first place, it's always been argued, or always argued, generally, by the talking head physicists, as if this is some sort of special experiment, when, no, the single-slit experiment creates a very similar pattern. Now, they like to call that diffraction, you see, instead of interference. And I pointed out how the MIT professor, though, points out quite emphatically that no, they're caused by the same phenomenon. And to explain the single slit, they use this idea of Huygens, where there's an infinite number of something in a confined space. So that's what physics is accepting as a model of reality. Just do the math. Anyway, so they come up with all this stuff you heard about, the many worlds, the Copenhagen idea, the radar, that the photon goes through both slits and has radar. All of that stuff is modeled on the idea of two slits and some necessity for two waves to be created to create interference. And yet in the single slit, there is no worry about what slit it went through. We know that the single photon went through one slit, and somehow it turned into two things that interfere with each other. That's the fact. And it's the claim of the established theory. All right. So they say they have this fantastic math that does all this brilliant predicting, and blah, 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 blah. And that these wave equations are just perfectly applicable and they don't have to be engineered or mandered into, you know, creating the right answer. And of course they do. And the more demanding you are for precision, the more insanely convoluted their equations get. But they will never work because of certain facts. And it's sort of like the general relativity thing. Unless you're willing to just say, you know, we're just going to suspend all practical reality and not accept the fact that the only way light can get across a spaceship going half the speed of light without missing the other side is it has to get there instantaneously. Because the only option is it has to go faster than the speed of light. But no, let's just pretend that that paradox isn't real. It isn't a fact. I know I changed it. Don't want to mix subjects. My bad, sorry. All right, so I have demonstrated how routinely, by highly professional physicists, in describing the two-slit experiment and this nail-in-the-coffin evidence, they cheat substantially and pretend that single slits don't create an interference pattern. You know, because it would mess up what they're trying to do. If they Huygensed if they made two single slits into four photons, their math wouldn't work. So they have to selectively Huygens in the right places. But that's another subject. That's what I want to get to. I've shown the Yale professor defending the idea of just ignoring the slits in the double slit experiment, because it's really about the thing in the middle. And then I've shown Professor Lewin pointing out that look, the same thing creates both these patterns. They're the same thing. They're not, one's not called diffraction and one is called interference, and they're somehow made by different functions. They're made by the same thing. The same mechanism is involved. So these people claim that I am some sort of Dunning-Kruger lunatic because, some idiot. Because I see a huge inconsistency in that. Especially considering this is supposed to be your nail in the coffin evidence of your wave theory of light. You shouldn't have to cheat on your nail in the coffin kind of thing. Should have that one right. All right, so this is the fundamental problem with the double slit experiment. So I'll explain again. Well, let's just do this crap again to understand that the single slit creates a pattern, and then the double slit creates a pattern that's substantially, the interior's the same, but it has a little more nuance to it. Okay, so the single slit does something like this, the double slit does something like this, brighter in the center, brighter in the center, all of that. But yes, it's the bars that are the important thing, and the fact that these bars are regulated in the double slit. And in the single slit, the wider you make the slit, that is, without going too wide, because then you'll null to a single point. See, this is the trick. The two have exactly the opposite effects. So if I widen the single slit, I'll get lots of pattern until there's a point where I'll just go to a single laser beam. The pattern will shrink smaller and smaller and smaller. In the double slit, the opposite would happen. As I widen the slit, so I get more pattern, and as I go even wider, there's a point where I just keep the pattern I have from the single impediment. So that's their problem. So I'll illustrate that. So if you have two slits, and then you have a barrier and a barrier, you can sort of understand that there's two things happening. There's four surfaces here, and that this thing is going to do something, and this thing might be doing something. Now, the math just says, let's just forget about this and just consider these point sources. And they'll just move the point sources through an infinite number of positions to create all the potential patterns. And the only thing relevant is this distance here. And this becomes their A, okay? And then D is the distance to the target. So this new version of the math they're showing me, well, D becomes this distance. I mean, it's either the distance between the centers or the distance of the thing itself. So I've seen it done both ways. And A becomes the width of the slits. So they just, completely change what the variables represent, which just makes the whole thing almost impossible to follow from one person doing the math to another person doing the math, because the variables have no consistency. You have to figure out what they think, what represents a D in both of those circumstances. So anyway, the problem I'm trying to illustrate here is that in the double slit, you have this weird circumstance that as I move the, if I open this slits wider, keep the same center impediment, and go wider and wider, there's a point where this does become irrelevant. There's a point where all I'm going to get is a certain amount of pattern as the light goes in here, and I'm going to get a certain amount of interference from these two surfaces, but these two surfaces will be irrelevant because they're too far away. And they don't have math that identifies that point. They don't have any structure or theory to deal with that truth. That's just the fact. And so all they've really done is take a gross simplification to say, look, it's an on-off pattern. That's the most recognized pattern in the universe. We always know that whenever we see an on-off pattern, that's interference. And it's just, it's a gross simplification, oversimplification, cheat, however you want to say it. This is something that needs to be played with. Now, none of any of the stuff they pointed to has any maths that are proved with experiments. So there's nothing demonstrated. There's no math finished. There's just a formula presented, and you're supposed to take it for what it says. And that's it. Now, the interesting point is one of the formulas does predict how many bars there should be in the central maxima and the next maxima. And so that's sort of interesting, because that I should be able to test as a formula. Now, whether that pattern is consistent. I could just test it on Google images of double slit patterns, for example. Because it appears like the math is saying something like there's twice as many bars in this middle section than there are in all of the other sections, and it certainly couldn't be all of them. See, the central maxima is this when the pattern shows up, the center pattern is twice as large as the other patterns. See, that's the trick here, is that intensity is being displayed as a, you know, in a manner that's not intensity, you know, it's height. And so it kind of distracts or isn't a perfect way of representing what's actually seen. Because what is seen is not only intensity, but actually there is some height, you know, difference. And obviously when there's too much intensity, you can't see the difference in the intensity anymore, because everything gets, you know, the eye can't adjust to the different brightnesses. And so the stuff that's either gets wiped out that's too bright, or you lose the stuff that's too dim. But anyway, too tired to think of the word for that now, but you know, the iris thing. Anyway, okay, so I guess I could, I mean, maybe that's enough of a statement, just to say that this creates a complexification that they don't deal with at all. You know, the idea that you have a pattern that's rudimentary, that won't change no matter what you do to the slits out here. This pattern of just the single impediment is, you know, there. And so, I mean, that would be the experiment, right? I mean, I've seen them use a variable slit, but what I haven't seen them use is a variable slit with a stagnant central impediment. And that would be really informative to see done. And I just haven't seen it done. So I'm just saying that, but this is the nail in the coffin experiment. This is the foundational experiment for all of quantum mechanics, the theory behind quantum mechanics. And you would just think, you know, that I shouldn't be doing this, speculating about this stuff, that somebody else would have already done all of this stuff. And they would also think that the story told by the different physicists would be consistent. And clearly, the stories aren't consistent. They're very inconsistent. They make very, they're rather emphatic and contradictory statements made by different physicists regarding what's happening. It's probably enough of that background. I just don't, you know, once I start the comments, I'm just going to get pissed off. So I guess I'll go to the couple of the links they sent, and I'll just play. You know, I haven't had nearly enough time to go into all of this bullshit math. And I'm sorry, I mean bullshit in the sense that, you know, it's never very, doesn't explain anything. You know, I mean, frankly, yeah, I, whatever. My bad, their bad, I don't know whose bad it is, but they don't make this math followable. All right, so this is the where one link by one of the assholes. And so it says, well, I'll read the stuff before we get here, because it goes through the whole Huygens thing, and it's just funny to read. Each slit has a width A. The distance between the center of each slit is d. So now d is the distance from the center points. Now, in the other guy's math, the D is going to be this, the width of the slit, this impediment. Now, this, what is this? See, I just know how, I don't know how they think this is logic, you know, what this represents. Because it just doesn't, there's no connect the dots between of this at all. They're both S's here. I don't know if you can see that, but it's both S's. S equals, I think it's an equal sign. I mean, I can't see very well, but that's probably an equal sign. All right, so it's basically half of D, okay, minus half of A. And then it's half of D plus half of A. What does that mean? The same variable, the two sources are 3 and 5. So if you put actual numbers in here, let's say this thing is 8 and these things are 2s, then you get 3 and 5. Now how is 3 and 5 helpful? Or how is that consistent with the slit widths being A? So what is S? Source is 3 and source is 5? How is that at all useful? For such a big diagram, I just thought it should do something a little more. Okay, I get that. So anyway, and then all of this math goes through here, blah, 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 blah. And you end up with this, by squaring the amplitude, we obtain I, whatever this is, theta thing. You know, 4a squared, okay. But there's absolutely nothing in here that has the distance to the target. So I don't know how they can judge intensity as an absolute. They must be judging intensity as something relative, if they're not going to have distance to the target, I think. But anyway, intensity of what? The central maxima? I mean, this doesn't say anything. So it doesn't finish anything. And again, there's no proof here. There's no, like I said, they never, you know, it'd be nice if they just did some examples. Well, here's a slit with this and the with that, and here's what we come up with. And go ahead and do the experiment, and you'll see it comes out that way. So it works out perfectly fine. No, I don't think so. All right. So let me go to this beginning part, because it is kind of funny. All right. So here we go. Actually, you're completely right. Most treatments of the Dibble slit experiment have some kind of simplification. Yeah, well, that's not good. The usual idea is that we approximate each slit in the double slit to be a point source. So that's sort of what the Yale guy is saying. Just screw it. Don't bother with it. So what you're really analyzing is the case of the two coherent point sources. You know, or the D, the distance to the middle of them, or the distance, the contrived distance of the central impediment. It really doesn't need to be the two slit experiment. It can just be the single needle experiment, the single impediment experiment. Is basically all they're basically conceding. This approximation can be justified by the assumption that your slits are really tiny compared to the distance between them and the wavelengths. Well, clearly, compared to the wavelengths, they're not really tiny. And they're not tiny compared to the distance between them. So, where's there any reason for anyone to assume they're any tinier than the single slit experiment? Where's the experiment done where they make the double slit slits smaller than the slits in the single slit experiment? I mean, it seems like the only time they do that is when they want to make the pattern smaller. But anyway, so I'm just saying, so this is nail in the coffin kind of descriptions of reality. That they're allowed to say that the slits or widths are so infinitesimal that there's no reason to consider them. When the whole point is they can be any size. And unlike in the single slit experiment, when you make them bigger, nothing happens. in the double slit experiment, you make them bigger and something still happens, which is really important. All right, when each slit is tiny, there are less amount of wavelets. Okay, so these are the Huygensies coming out. There are infinitely many, but hopefully my point still makes sense. So there's less wavelets when the slits are tiny. And again, so the implication is that somehow the slits are smaller than the single slit. And the evidence is exactly the opposite. Because the only way they make that silly, almost no bars pattern in the single slit experiment is to make the slit tiny, tiny, tiny. Because if you make the single slit big, like a half a millimeter or more, you get lots of bars. So if you use a half millimeter or more slit opening in a double slit, you get lots of bars. Good pattern. So this whole thing that it's somehow an infinitesimally small slit in the double slit, I don't think that's true. I don't think so. Alright. there are an infinite many, but hopefully my point still makes sense. So again, that's the game they play. Well, yes, it goes faster than the speed of light, but no, it doesn't really. And if there are less amount of wavelets coming out, there are less of them to be out of phase. I mean, imagine it's still a percentage that are out of phase, so what's the difference?
Yeah.
Anyway, I mean, that's just... Make the light brighter, it doesn't change anything. I guess unless you make it really bright or something. Anyway, when you make your opening smaller and smaller, the two wavelets most out of phase are closer and closer. And they are more and more in phase. So, I mean, these are supposed to be nail-in-the-coffin kind of sentences. So when you make your opening smaller and smaller, you get less and less bars. They spread out more and more. The bars get thicker and thicker. So you get less and less of them. The two wavelets most out of phase are closer and closer, wherever the wavelets are, and they are more and more in phase. The two wavelets most out of phase are closer and closer, and they are more and more in phase. That makes sense to somebody. The two wavelets most out of phase are closer and closer, and they are more and more in phase. So the two things out of phase are now more in phase. Whatever. Indeed, I'm just reading this crap. Indeed, in the case of the single slit, when you make the slit opening smaller and smaller, the middle bar becomes wider. Yes, that's true. At some point, it becomes so wide that you might as rather approximate the slit as a point source. Well, yes, because you won't see any pattern, you'll just see a big divergence of the light. So what does that mean? I mean, the more important fact is that if you make the slit wider, you'll get 40, 50 fringes. Not diffractions, interference fringes. Of course, you actually can do the full treatment of both the single slit and the double slit in detail, assuming far field approximations. So, assuming whatever that means, a bunch of approximations. But highly convoluted math nonetheless, even though there's approximations in it. Oh, God. In fact, you can get the full-blown function that describes the pattern. I don't think you can. The derivation gets messy. Yeah. But the idea is that you have infinitely many wavefronts coming out, and you want to add up the effects of each wavefront, each of which is infinitesimally small. Well, I guess it would have to be if there's an infinite number of them in there. They must be awful tiny. It turns out this will require integral to sum them up. Well, of course it will. Much of the same way people speak of integrals adding up infinitesimal area. So, and that's just approximating.
That itself is an approximation, doing an integral. So when you do this, the intensity of the wave at the screen is, and so that it just starts with I theta, which I don't know what that means. I little zero, I don't know what that means. So, you know, no point. I guess a zero would mean at the zero locations. That'd be the central maxima. I don't know. So anyway, yeah, forget that. I'm not going to be able to follow that crap. Bottom line is, this is what people think the reality is. This is their nail in the coffin evidence, is the idea there's an infinite number of something in a confined space. That's the premise of their theory. And it sucks as a theory. So anyway, let's see what the original question was. When dealing with the double slit interference or interference of waves from numerous slits, the equation n, so I know n is the number of maximas, lambda equals d sine theta. However, I do not understand why for calculating the angle of maxima and minima, it's okay to consider the path difference of waves from each slit. There are only one wave from each slit is considered. Where only one wave from each slit is considered. Surely there are numerous waves from each slit, following Huygens' principle that each wave and the wave from a certain secondary wavelet. Therefore, surely there is interference of infinite waves from each slit. Therefore, surely it is unfair to assume that if one wave interferes in a certain way with another wave from another slit, then all the waves from each slit will interfere the same way. Well, there is a reason to think there's going to be a pattern to the interference. So it's kind of funny that this answer wasn't even to a question that really, it was more of a question about how do you reduce an infinite number of things to the simplicity of the pattern, and that would be, that explanation could come out of the whole, this is really just a divergence. So that's where the pi comes in. So I think they do inject pi into these equations. So they're basically taking a straight line, turning it into a curved line to create the approximated points. And then you're just approximating, like, you're cutting a pi that you could cut. Obviously, you could cut a pi into an infinite number of slices. But to get the point of it, you just need four, right? You know, then you get the idea of a piece of pi. And, I mean, it's not a perfect analogy, but, no, it's not a perfect analogy. So anyway, so this diagram is the cliche, let's superimpose the complex pattern, with the dull version of the single slit. So again, the single slit can produce 40 of these bulges. 40. And they always draw it like this. Always. And the end result of this equation is, just like these others, very confusing. So they say that this is determined by the width of the slit. So that's what they're saying, is that this distance is determined by the width of the slit, which means that all the distances must be. But I would argue that clearly it's not going to be determined by the width of the slit, because once I get the width of the slit to a certain width, this isn't going to ever change again. This distance will stay absolutely static once I move, once the width of the slit becomes more than a millimeter. This won't be relevant anymore. This will be a static, unchanging dimension. And I don't think their math has a catch for that. But that's all they would do, is create a catch. They'd create a way to catch the number when it got to a certain percentage of theta. That kind of crap. So anyway, they come up with this simplistic equation. That doesn't answer anything. M is the number, so that means the number of slits, I believe. The number of fringes. And And then, so they just have this simple D over A thing. And that's not going to get you there. But what I did when you start doing the addition here, it ends up saying basically that there are half of the fringes are in the central maxima, and they're not. There's twice as many even in this image of these. And like I said, if you do this pattern wider, I think your percentages do change. I don't think they stay static. So, it'd be worth doing to find out. But anyway, as you can see, there's a lot to go over in here. But, I mean, this is kind of a grotesque simplification here. I don't think this can have any use in this argument. Because this is too simple. I mean, it's obviously, this obviously doesn't catch. If I open this, if I make the slits very, very wide, there's no catch in this to fix the problem that's going to be created, where there isn't going to be any change in the pattern. All right. So I don't know how much more I want to devote to this. So I'll just say something general about the comments, because I don't know if I want to read each one. It's just the you know, unacceptably rude. What else is news? You know, Nikki Tech does keep saying, you know, I don't think you understand the nature of the communication impasse here. Let's break this down to easily digestible chunks. First, you saw a video from the actual Yale professor. Second, the actual Yale professor stated that slit width is not in the double slit equation. Third, you are stating that slit width is in the equation. So, yes, they're saying they have an equation. It's just nobody uses it. Yeah, that's what they're saying. But, again, I don't have any way to test their equation because they don't test it. They don't show it tested. All right. But, anyway. But, like, you know, Mindless just keeps pointing more and more different theories, French wave theory, this, you know. You know, he's taking a quote from this video, so I guess I'll go to this one eventually. So there, I took the size of every slit to be vanishingly small. That means the light coming out of the slit, light spreads out completely in all directions. Vanishingly small. Where does that have anything to do with the real world experiment? The slits aren't vanishingly small. I wouldn't have to dig up this quote if Menem had a decent courtesy to actually read the link I posted. It literally explains why. Huh? I don't think so. For the sake of simplicity, people assume the slits in the double slit setup are made extra small to be approximated as point sources. I don't think people do any of this assuming. The whole argument is that everybody describing the experiment, the professionals, aren't describing it accurately, and you keep taking no account for that whatsoever. Here you are harassing me. Why aren't you harassing them? Why don't you go tell Professor Lewin he's full of shit? Why don't you go tell the guy at Yale he's full of shit? After all, as you make the slits narrower, the middle bar for the single slit gets large enough that you approximate it like a point source. Well, obviously, it's not much of a point source if you're spreading the light. It's when it reaches the target, it's hardly a point source. Again, the link actually answered that too. Okay, so what link? This YouTube video? Well, you have to read the link I posted. What link? Oh, he's just so annoying. You've posted 7,000 links. The link. You keep saying the link. What link? Let's see. So, okay. Tell me if this is satisfactory enough. The reason he states the slit width isn't in the equation is because, for the purpose of making things simpler, he is approximating the slits as point sources in the link I quoted, I provide, he literally says this.
I'm just amazing. And you're saying this is a legitimate way to do the most precise math in the universe that answers all questions and predicts all solutions.
Is there something not clear about that? There's something incredibly dishonest about that. That's the point. This is supposed to be your nail in the coffin evidence, and you're basically saying, nah, fuck that. Fuck any precision. Fuck getting anything close to right. We just say it makes this interferencing thing, and that's close enough. Isn't that close enough? I mean, it's just bullshit. It's just really... I mean, this guy, the Samuel Hayden guy, I guess I should just block him now. Why anyone bothers responding to Nikki Tech is beyond me. So Nikki Tech just writes a simple question, right? This was not in any way rude or obnoxious. It's just saying, look, this is the argument and its progression. Why don't you explain why the Yale professor is saying what he's saying? And then why don't you explain why, he could have added, why Professor Lewin is saying what he's saying, instead of giving me grief. That's good enough and should warrant a serious reply. Gary, if you read this, oh, here we go. Here is Marble's explanation of why the Yale professor stated there is no slit width in the equation. The reason he states is a slit width isn't in the equation is because for the purpose of making things simpler. Okay, I'm just saying the simplification has nothing to do then with what the actual pattern does, because clearly if I took a double slit experiment and I widen the outside barriers, the outside part of the slit, I'm going to create huge changes in the pattern. And apparently their math doesn't know what that is or how to deal with that. He is approximating the slits as point sources. Well, why don't we just approximate the single slit as a point source then? Oh, that's right, because then there wouldn't be any Huygens, there wouldn't be two photons, there wouldn't be any math at all. It would just, the laser would go straight through and be a point. So, yeah, that doesn't work at all, does it? In the link I quoted, I provide, he literally says this. This could represent progress. I don't think it does, but anyway. Anyway, it's a ton of crap here. Just a ton of it. So he did this whole Dunning-Kruger thing, which is really obnoxious. Because who is this unaccountable motherfucker? Who is this prick who sits there and claims to know what he's talking about, know this, know that, and he can just keep citing me to all these links? He's nobody. One subscriber. So he's a big fan of Iron Ra and Holiday, the dumbest motherfucker on earth. conference report. Yeah, so what else have we got on this list of douchebags? Looking glass, I don't even know what that means. So anyway, what's your deal, you fucking asshole? I mean, you don't deal with the argument being made, ever. You just keep reiterating. Lasers shoot crooked when they're going fast. That's the way it is. Lasers shoot crooked. Whatever. Oh, here's something Feynman said. Lewin and the Yale guy's dicks are so far up your ass. Okay, so isn't that amazing? He's saying that to me. Right? I'm just looking for what conventional physics says is your physics. And here you're sitting there saying, these are my guys? These aren't my guys. Oh, man. You can't even see the real full equation when it's literally in front of you. Walter Lewin is a fucking meme. What? And that's all you can attach yourself to. I think Walter Lewin's full of shit. He's a Huygens fan. I think Huygens is a silly and preposterous starting point. It has no chance of being the truth. It's crap, okay? And you're getting the right answers for the wrong reasons, as it has been pointed out. And that's all there is to it. You stupid, smelly, tofu-brained, I don't eat tofu, idiot. No one is saying Einstein said this, Feynman said that. No one is? I think that's all that Pirro ever did. You are. No, you are. Because you have no capacity of understanding any actual physics beyond cartoon memes. So again, this is coming from this fucking cunt. So here I'm arguing for a completely different theory. A particle theory. I'm arguing, and these assholes tell me they have a great theory. They have it all figured out. It's all great. We got this stuff nailed. It's nail in the coffin. It's a wave. We know it. We're sure. And I'm like, no, it's not. Space isn't bent. There's no wave crap. It's bullshit. There's no ethers. There's no fucking fields. There's no fucking time dilation in a dimension thing because time isn't a fucking dimension, you fucking idiots. I'm arguing with all this shit. But the only way I can argue with it is I have to go to who your people are. So you're again another one of you're your own dung and cruder outsider. You're saying the conventional physics is wrong. They're stupid. They're idiots. They're memes. They're cartoon physics. Cartoons, he calls it. I mean, what the fuck? Those other experiments are not double slit experiments. Oh, I'm sorry, they are too. It's the same damn thing. The one has two point sources pointed at a mirror. Now, how isn't that a double slit experiment? Right, so one has two point sources at bent mirrors. So you get the idea that it's basically the double slit experiment, because now you're just creating two point sources and now you're bending the mirror to create the difference in length, path length. And the other experiment is a single slit, but with a mirror where the double slit would have been, where the next slit would have been. So there's a distance, and then a single slit, and then a plane mirror. So obviously the mirror is just reflecting the light from the one slit and creating a second slit in a way. What an asshole. Anyway. Where does interference come from in the Fresnel biprism or the Lloyd mirror? Yeah, both of those experiments. I just described both of those experiments. Go on, idiot, he says. All right, so at 39:05, he says, I said, what wave equation are you applying to electrons? I think Einstein made it clear that electrons move by energy. You don't need a wave equation. Yeah, you have no clue at all, he says. I was talking about light wave equations, not about electrons. Light wave equations related to... You used the word electrons, I was just pointing out. So I don't know what light wave equations have to do with electrons. If the end effect's going to be the electrons have to be moved in the quantized way. You stupid retard. You're literally saying a bunch of crap that has no... relevance, thinking like it's going to mean something. Well, the point is yes, I do think it's going to mean something, because frankly, I think it is the truth, okay? Light isn't a wave. It's quantized energy. I don't ask about how light releases electrons. I didn't ask about how light releases electrons. No, what you're getting to, though, is why there's a perpendicular release of virtual photons, EMF. I asked how light waves oscillate electrons sideways. Okay, so now you're saying you actually think they oscillate sideways. Okay. I was asking how light waves oscillate electrons sideways exactly the same way as predicted by Maxwell's equations. Says you. That's not what Maxwell's equations predict. I mean, you can interpret them that way. You can come up with a Copenhagen or a many worlds interpretation. But those are just interpretations. They have nothing to do with the fundamental equations. The fundamental equations are just saying the force. The fundamental equations aren't explaining the nature of the force. You explain magnetism and electricity, but your theory only makes light push electrons in the direction the light is moving. Well, no, it doesn't. And as I pointed out so many times, and I
you know, I can't, you have to pay attention to the video. So if you don't want to, if you're not willing to do that, then, you know, there's just not much point. But I have gone over the fact that electrons don't move straight. So, you know, the point is they're constant. That's why they, that's why they don't carry momentum. They don't maintain velocity. Is because once the force comes into them, then okay, they get more going one way. So say if they have 10 arrows going this way and 8 arrows going this way, the force keeps hitting them from the side. And clearly the side with 10 is more likely to get hit than the side with 8. So it's always going to start balancing just by probabilistic law. So if there's 50% of stuff coming this way and 50% coming this way, you can kind of get the idea that the 10 side is going to be affected more than the 8 side probabilistically, and so it's always going to end up getting reduced over time. And part of that reduction leads to the fact that what you're converting, when the perpendicular EMF is produced, it means not only did the electron get a boost going this way, but it got a boost going the opposite of this way. See, it converted an arrow going in, an inside arrow got converted from going this way to going this way. And the arrow coming in got converted from an arrow going this way to an arrow going this way. And so the net effect is you've got an imbalance in this direction and an imbalance in this direction. That's why electrons don't fly straight, fuckhead. So that's not a light treatment. That's not trivial. You're so rude. All right. You know, so that's probably enough. Like I said, there's so much crap here. You know, I just don't know if I have the time or the will to be obedient to all of this. I mean, Brian Greene. So apparently he likes Brian Greene. So he doesn't like the Yale professor and doesn't like Lewin, but he likes Brian Greene, who I think is a string theory guy. Can't remember. Anyway, so anyway, but this is just rude premise. And Mendham is a textbook victim of Dung and Kreger. Yeah, I could just say it about you. A little knowledge is a dangerous thing, and yeah, you're a dangerous dumb fuck. This effect is corroborated by countless times in Mendham spouted complete nonsense. Like what? Yeah, right. You can't get light to the other side of the spaceship if the spaceship's moving without giving it a second momentum, and that's a problem. Yeah, oh yeah, that's I'm stupid. You people gave light to momentums. I'm the idiot. Mm-hmm. He thought of reference frames or fucking boxes or something. Well, they might as well be. Certainly when Einstein bent light, it's a box. In the sense that the light goes into the gravity well and then the light has to pull its way out of the gravity well. So there's a conservation there. But in your time frames, there's no conservation. Which demonstrates he has negative capacity to attack SR. I don't even know what that means. Silly. Negative capacity. No, I have capacity to attack it, and I have done it as just a pile of made-up shit. With no real evidence defending it. But the magic frames take care of it all, because somehow the frames know somehow where to create the borders. Right, exactly. So you create, like I said, it's just, you know, I mean, you could have made it easier experiment to describe. I mean, you're shooting light across a spaceship. The spaceship wall is moving. They're claiming this, the light can figure out that the spaceship is moving, go this extra distance, and somehow it's not moving that way. And it didn't have to move faster than the speed of light to get there. I mean, where's the conservation in any of that?
I mean, how does the where how does this light that has to be going faster than the speed of light, how does it slow down when it goes through the hole? How does it know, oh, I'm not supposed to go faster than the speed of light. I have to stop doing that. The baseball can't do it. When I give a baseball two momentums, it doesn't get to say, I went out the bus window, now I'll slow down to regular speed. So when I give a baseball two momentums, it doesn't figure out, oh, I'm in the real world now, I'll just go back to regular speed. But somehow a light photon does. And I say that's a pile of shit. Well, anyway, I'm not going to do all this. There's no point in doing all this. He points to the Coulomb force law and calls it Maxwell's equations. Well, I mean, Maxwell's equations are essentially dependent, largely, on Gauss's and Coulomb and all of that crap, because it's the only way you can create the conservation. The only way you can collect all of the field effects. So you have to use gimmicks to really apply Maxwell's equations. I mean, the equations don't mean much, and you know, it's almost like making the argument that when you want to illustrate you know, the true nature of something, you create the infinite plane, you know, in these kind of equations. And if you create these infinite planes, like if I create an infinite light source, you know, a plane light source, then no matter how far I would go away, the light would always be the same intensity. Those kind of things can't be illustrated without, you know, those kinds of mechanisms. So maybe you don't see the connections between them, but I do. You can apply to gravity also knows, yeah, exactly. Well, I'm just saying, if you don't think Maxwell's equation, so here it says right here, you can apply it to gravity. He also shows no understanding what Gauss's law. And, well, I'm just saying, the very point is that Maxwell's equations are essentially a recognition that magnetism is functioning in a lot of fundamental ways the same way as gravity, that these forces are related. I mean, Maxwell's equations are nothing without the inverse square law. And that's the whole point of the infinite plane, because it gets rid of the inverse square law. And then when you make the infinite wire, it becomes, you know, the is it R cubed or R, just R? I guess it's just R. The R rule, where, you know, now you're only R squaring in one dimension. And so it's half the effect. Anyway, I mean, fuck. I mean, this is just useless tripe, you fucking cunt. I mean, if you can't refrain from your petty bullshit remarks, then fuck you. Go away. This shows he has no awareness of relativistic Doppler formulas. Yeah, well, I don't have any real awareness, because I think they're wrong. I think that's why they don't have the speed of anything correct to the universe. And here's bringing up Dunning-Kruger again. But here's another reason Amendum is an example of Dunning-Kruger effect. He can't distinguish established physics from Pirro's EMF conception of light. Established physics. I can't distinguish established physics from Pirro's EMF conception of light. No, I am making that distinction. I've made the accusation that I'm not going to argue Pirro's special physics. What's the point of doing that? I have to argue with the established perception, not Pirro's, it's really an ether. You can't distinguish when someone knows what he's talking about, like who? You said Lewin doesn't, okay, and the guy at Yale doesn't. Who do you think knows what they're talking about? You? Fucking idiot. From someone who doesn't. Let's compare the symptoms of this effect to Mendham's characteristics. Fail to recognize their own lack of skill. Well, I think I've been pretty skillful in the sense that I've created a theory
that, like Einstein's bent space, actually does work. It actually does meet most of the observed findings in the universe. And I've created something very simple, a mechanism that not only creates photons, but explains EMF, and also explains the strong nuclear force. And well, there's no point, you know, in arguing with somebody this stupid. I mean, obviously, my own skill is not insubstantial, that I engineered, okay, a mechanism that made particle theory explain gravity, and without the same thermodynamic problems it had 300 years ago. Failed to recognize the extent of their inadequacy. By your definition, failed to accurately gauge skill in others. Like who? I mean, again, who are your heroes here? So you go ahead. The guy at Yale's, nah, not so good. Professor Lewin, he's an idiot. So who are your heroes? Recognize and acknowledge their lack of skill only after they are exposed to training for that skill. Whatever that means. Yeah, I'd love to see anyone actually dispute this. I dare anyone to say I'm wrong. Well, I think you're motherfucking cunt wrong, and I think you're a coward. If you're going to type this kind of crap, then you ought to make videos, you coward. You ought to put your fucking name and reputation on the line. If you think I'm so full of shit, why not dare, okay? Why not put yourself out there, okay? So I can do what I'm going to do to Pirro for the rest of his life, which is humiliate the shit out of him. Because you people are just authoritarian tyrants. I've pointed out how 99% of the available content on physics is trivial treatments of the truth. Trivialized and inaccurate. And you don't say anything about that. You don't do anything about that. You type this crap to me. Why don't you do this Dung and Kreger crap to Lewin and the guy at Yale? And why don't you do it to even your Brian Greene guy? Why don't you do it to all those people? I think Brian Greene pointed out in a video once that, you know, physics is pretty embarrassing, you know, because, oh yeah, one third of them think it's Copenhagen, one third of them think there's multiverses, and one third of them thinks whatever the other stupid idea is. And it's about a double slit experiment where if they just look at the single slit, they don't have to worry about all their stupid fucking idiotic interpretations, because all their interpretations go away. No more need for interpretations anymore. You don't have to worry about what slit it went through.
Anyway, fuck you.